Welcome to the 26th video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this video, we're going to talk about how you quantize light. And I just want to start by saying, I don't believe you should take a quantum mechanics course and not understand what a photon really is. If all you get out of a quantum mechanics class is a photon is a particle of light, then we have failed you. So in this chapter of the book, we talk in detail about what a photon is. In order to do that, we have to quantize light. We also tell you about how photons can be detected, how you can make single photon sources, and what a single photon really is. And that is one of the things that I think is most important to understand. Along the way, after you do all of that work, you can understand why squeezed states, or more technically, a squeezed vacuum is used in LIGO in order to improve the precision with which you can measure gravitational waves. So the image that I have for you here is the image of a photomultiplier tube. A photon hits a metallic sample and via the photoelectric effect emits an electron. That emitted electron cascades and hits a series of very high voltage electric plates that are called dynodes, and it releases extra electrons with each interaction with the dynode, and then you get a sizable current at the end that you can measure with a regular ammeter. So that's the way a photomultiplier tube works. This is a G2 experiment. This is an experiment that tells me that I have a single photon source, and understanding how a G2 experiment works is one of the critical things you need to know in order to say you actually understand what a photon is. Chapter 20, Quantizing Light. So we start off with the quantization of Maxwell's equations. You do need to know a little bit about Maxwell's equations, but we don't talk about them in the differential form because I'm not assuming you have any calculus background. But we have enough information to do it in a way that it makes sense what it is we're doing with the quantization of light. We then talk about single photon detectors, such as that photomultiplier tube. We then talk about single photon sources. The original source is a atomic cascade source coming from calcium. It's a very interesting way in which that source was created. That's what's called a heralded source. You actually get two photons out. And many of the single photon sources are heralded sources, which allows you to do more interesting things in experiments because you have something that tells you exactly when the photon was emitted. We then talk about heterodyne and homodyne detection of photons because the photon frequency is so fast you can't measure it on an oscilloscope, so you need to use different techniques in order to measure them. We then apply our second quantization approach to the Mach-Zehnder interferometer. We then introduce something that's really cool called a Franzen interferometer. This is entangling in time, and that's just such a cool concept. I had to have an entire section to explain how that works to you. And then we talk about LIGO and the use of a squeezed vacuum. And again, I think LIGO is such an incredible engineering achievement that everyone who takes quantum mechanics should understand how LIGO works and understand why they use squeezed states. Hey guys, let's go browse through the chapter. Chapter 20, Quantizing Light. This is a quote from an artist, Agnes Dennis. Pattern finding is the purpose of the mind and the construct of the universe. A lot of problems that we work with, especially in many body physics, involve our having to work with complex patterns. This is something that arises when you start thinking about things like boson sampling problem and so forth. And so I found this to be an appropriate quote in talking about quantizing light. So we have to start with Maxwell's equations. Here's an image of Maxwell. And we essentially start by telling you what the electric and magnetic fields are and then describing how the different Maxwell equations work, but sort of telling you what the answers are. No derivatives, no differential equations. We just work with the wave numbers. And I think you'll find it's pretty clear. I don't think you will feel like you're missing out if you've never seen Maxwell's equations before. The amount that we need to know is not that much. And really, if you've never seen it before, you'll just have to trust me. If you have seen it before, I think you will find it pretty clear and easy to follow where everything is coming from. Then after that, it essentially boils down to solving particle in a box. And we know how to solve particle in a box, so we can kind of write down the solution. And then, as I had mentioned before, essentially what happens is we take the real part of the electric field amplitude and the imaginary part of the electric field amplitude, and because the energy involves the square of the amplitude, we find the Hamiltonian is the sum of the square of the real part plus the imaginary part. And we also find that they satisfy a commutation relation that is the same as the commutation relation of a Q with a P. And what this does is it actually allows us to describe them by harmonic oscillators. It's kind of a coincidence that it turns out to be harmonic oscillators. It is not anything to do with the fact that there is some mysterious restoring force for electromagnetic radiation and there are all these springs surrounding us in the world. No, there's nothing like that. It's just a mathematical coincidence that the form of the way that we deal with photons is the same as a harmonic oscillator. But because of that, we can take all of the stuff we've learned about harmonic oscillators and they carry through to light. And so it is a really useful language to use to help us understand how light works. So here we get into showing how you do that quantization of light. We then look at different states of light. Now those A daggers are creating photons that are photons that have specific energies. So the index is the mode of the photon, and that mode has a specific energy. We talk about a lot of things. The vacuum has interesting properties to it. Then we move on to looking at how a single photon detector works. The classic example of that is the photomultiplier tube. I've already explained to you how that works earlier in this video. There are other kinds of single photon detectors, including ones made out of superconductors. We briefly talk about how that works. Then we talk about how a single photon source works. This is the calcium cascade single photon light source. It's a very interesting device. It requires a two photon transition to go from the 4s to the 4p state. And then it spontaneously decays to this intermediate state. And the lifetime of that intermediate state is less than a nanosecond, where you have a second decay. So that first photon coming out heralds the fact that you're going to get a second photon within about a nanosecond. And that allows you to do experiments, because once you have heralded the photon, you know that a photon, another photon is going to come out. There are other single photon sources now. The most common uses nonlinear crystals. It uses parametric down conversion, and those are often heralded photons as well. There is current work that is trying to make single photon sources on demand. You push a button and a photon comes out. Those use quantum dots to make them, and they're starting to get to be quite efficient. Once I have created my single photon sources, we then talk about experiments that can be used to detect them. And the key thing about a photon is it can be detected once and only once. And we talk about that and why that's important. We look at experiments that test the idea. And we show actual experiments that have measured these things. Then we look at another experiment that looks at the fact that you can measure a photon once and only once. You put it on a beam splitter and you never see both detectors go off. It's always one detector or the other. This is a classic experiment that looks at measuring photons, and that measurement allows us to do what's called the G2 measurement. And that G2 measurement, when this coefficient alpha is less than one, then you have a single photon source. If you put a dim laser on this experiment with the beam splitters, you would always get an alpha coefficient that was higher than one. So dim lasers are never single photon sources, even though you will find quantum textbooks that will say, we make it into a single photon in our experiment by making the laser very dim. No, that is not a single photon experiment. You don't get single photon statistics. It is not the same thing. So understanding that difference is one of the key things that we talk about in this section. We have a lot of problems that help us understand how that works. Then we move on to heterodyne and homodyne detection. This is essentially comparing the signal you want to measure with another signal that has either the same or nearly the same frequency. And that allows you to look at the beat of the signal. And that makes the signal at a low enough frequency that you can measure it on an oscilloscope or with photo multipliers or other things like that. So this is the strategy that's used for measuring photons. The homodyne detection is essentially using the same signal, and the input into the beam splitter on one of the input channels is very high in amplitude. This helps you compensate for the dark noise of your photodetectors, and because of that, it then allows you to get more accurate measurements, even with a very weak signal. We then apply our second quantization to the Mach-Zehnder interferometer, and there's lots of interesting things both in the technique that is used to do the calculation and in the results that come out, and so we talk about that in great detail. We also talk about what happens when you use a polarizing beam splitter, and then you can do very interesting single photon experiments with delayed choice and other things like that. There's lots of interesting stuff that comes up with that. Here's an image of Jim Franson. He's the inventor of the Franson interferometer. As I mentioned, this is a really cool interferometer. You take paired photons and you send them off in two directions through something that looks like Mach-Zehnder interferometers, but as you see, the organization isn't exactly the same because I have the two mirrors in a different geometry here with the way in which it works. And the photon either goes through the short path or it goes through the long path. And when both photons are short or both photons are long, you get an interference between those two effects, even though they're occurring at different times. And that's how you get entanglement in time. And it's a really cool concept, and it's really fun to go through and analyze this in detail. Even though I've done it many times, I still think it must be wrong. In fact, many well-established quantum optics people thought that it was wrong, and Jim Franson had a big fight to show that the Franson interferometer really is correct. And it's now something that is used a lot in quantum communication. And then our last segment, our last section is on squeezed light and LIGO, as I had promised. We talk about how LIGO works, how it can measure gravitational waves. And this is a schematic of what LIGO is. It's a Michelson-Morley interferometer, and it has these Fabry-Perot cavities, which make the effective path of the interferometer much, much longer than the size of it itself. Even though it's 4 kilometers, it looks like it's 1,200 kilometers. And we talk about what squeezed light does, the different kinds of squeezed light that you can have, and how that's used in the measurement. And of course, we have the image of the gravitational waves. And then we have some questions about it, and that takes us to the end of chapter 20. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.